Okay guys, welcome to Energy and ATP. Pretty short one this one. We're going to talk about the currency of living organisms, which is this molecule, adenosine triphosphate. Now, adenosine triphosphate is something that we are going to come back and visit again and again in A-level biology. It's used throughout an organism using a variety of different processes, as we'll see, and forms the sort of, as I said at the start there, the currency, the amount of energy that's used for various different processes around living things is moved around in this molecule. So we know that energy can't be made or destroyed, just transferred from one form to another. So energy is stored within this molecule and passed on to things that need it for various different processes. So let's look at the structure and then we'll talk about how that happens. So we've just done a video on nucleic acids, and this is a nucleotide derivative. So we've got an adenine base here. So there's the adenine, which is a nitrogen-containing base. See that in DNA. We've got a ribose sugar. So this is the 5-carbon sugar similar to RNA. And then we've got 3 phosphate molecules. So energy is stored within each of these bonds, and because they have a kind of relatively low activation energy here, these bonds, it doesn't take much to kind of split the phosphate and detach it, releasing that energy for whatever process is required. Now, that being said, like all biological molecules, when we are splitting ATP into ADP, which stands for adenosine diphosphate, so when we go from ATP to ADP, which produces one inorganic phosphate, and that's what that IP stands for, and we see that in textbooks and stuff we read elsewhere. What we're saying there is that this molecule, essentially all of this, forms ADP, and then this phosphate here, which is left over, represents this inorganic phosphate. So that process there to change ATP into ADP, as we've seen before, is a hydrolysis reaction, requires water. And the opposite, putting water back in to make ATP, is condensation. We've seen with all biological molecules, very important. So this is going to be one of those ones where we compare nucleic acids, we compare the processes, very common to come up. A smaller bit of the spec, but aside from understand about the molecule itself and how that reaction works, we've got to know about the advantages. So fundamentally, it's a one-step process, which means that we only have to snap off one phosphate to release energy. Now, that means it's immediate and it's available right away. So ATP is an energy store, but only kind of short-term. We only keep a small amount of ATP within living cells. Kind of longer-term stores are going to be glycogen, other carbohydrates, starch in plants, and fats, lipids, which are the long-term storage molecules. This is a very immediate source of energy. So it only releases a small amount of energy, as it's a one-step reaction, but this small amount of energy that's released means that we don't waste any energy. So it's a bit like a parking meter. If you go to a parking meter and it doesn't give you any change, and you've only got pound coin, but it's only going to cost you 20 pence for the hour, it's a waste to put that pound coin into the meter and pay for that parking. You're wasting that energy. So by just releasing a small amount of energy, we can just use more ATP and add it up, and it gives us more of an exact accurate amount of energy that we need. So the last thing we need to know about ATP is what it is used for. So a few key processes, metabolic processes, require ATP. So things that go on within the cell, building molecules, breaking molecules down, for example, glucose and into polysaccharides, or changing amino acids into proteins. It's going to require that. It allows muscles to move, so ATP is required for movement. Muscles to contract, and that allows movement. Secretion of products, so exocytosis, packaging, modifying, and moving them out and around the body. Sometimes ATP is involved in activation of molecules. So this particularly happens in sort of enzyme-catalyzed reactions. We'll learn about something called cyclic AMP and how that's converted by an enzyme called adenyl cyclase in A2. That requires ATP activating enzyme pathways. And then sort of kind of most importantly, I'd say, or something that we're going to visit a lot in AS, is active transport. So at GCSE, we learn about active transport taking place in the small intestines and in plants in the